goes, Mary had a little lamb. Little lamb, little lamb. Mary had a little lamb with a side of greens and ham. It's not quite right, is it? Everyone knows that fable, Mary, the nursery rhyme about Mary and her little lamb. And we always used to sing it that way because we're boys. So that's the way it goes. But we had the idea of a good shepherd, my shepherd. The idea of taking care of sheep. And this whole story of Mary and her little lamb, she took it everywhere and it followed her and took care of it. But sometimes we feel like we're following the carnivorous Mary. That we're being led around to the slaughter sometimes. Or we felt abandoned, or we felt let go, or we felt out a little bit. Right? You ever been there? You ever felt that? If you say no, you're lying. So we all been there, right? Whether from our own wandering or from the Lord testing us and growing us. So today we're going to look at one of those old favorite verses that everyone seems to know and we hear a lot. It's a Psalm 23. So if you would, open your Bibles to Psalm 23 with me. We're going to kind of work our way through this and hopefully get some new perspectives, some new encouragements. All right. I hear some pages turning, so I don't want to get too far ahead. All right, please follow along with me. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for His name's sake. This is the first part of this beautiful psalm here. And it's written by David, King David, who grew up being a shepherd boy. He grew up being out there tending the sheep day in and day out. And so I will imagine this is one of his dark times, maybe when King Saul was trying to kill him and he was hiding in caves or when he's running. He thought back to that time when he was a shepherd. Maybe he thought back to how he took care of his sheep and how his sheep looked to him and how he recalls the time where he fought a bear to protect his sheep, the time he fought a lion through the power of God to protect his sheep. Maybe he thought of that as a shepherd. We have this saying here. Where he's saying, look, the Lord is my shepherd, shall not want. It's a beautiful picture here. So if you would, we're going to talk about God as a shepherd. If we want to really engage this verse, we really want to engage this psalm, we need to first think about who it is about. Because the main focus of this psalm is not us, but it is God. He is the good shepherd. So God is a shepherd. First thing we see here is that He is provider. He's the provider. He takes care of His sheep, right? He keeps them safe. He gives them the food they need. It says that He leads me beside still waters. He gives me green pastures. And then the imagery here is that of a sheep not just going out and grazing, but kind of like laying out in the green pastures, enjoying that. You guys ever drove by and see like the animals rolling around, like llamas. Do we have llamas around here? I don't know what it was. When I went to college at SBU, there's some llamas out there in Bolivar, and someone was raising llamas out where I went to seminary, out in Kentucky. So I don't know what it was. I was just always surrounded by llamas. But llamas like to roll around, I guess, in the dust and whatever. It's a fascinating thing to watch. But I get this picture here. When it says, He leads me to green pastures. These are still waters. That beautiful picture there of a place, a sanctuary, right? Where not just a little grass here and there, but just big fields where I can roll and enjoy and be comforted because I can see grass forever, right? Those happy cows, they get to see all that green grass out there. That's the imagery I have here, that God, the provider, that He's got that for us. Because He is God the shepherd. Next, God is also the protector. He takes care of us. When the animals come, when the danger comes, what can stop our God? I think of a normal shepherd who may be able to fight some animals off. But think about God Almighty. All right, the God who created everything. Not the little God of your imagination, but the God Almighty. Jesus said, you know, don't fear this world that can only destroy your body, but fear God who can destroy your body and your soul. That God that Jesus warned us about is the God that wants to protect us. We should find some comfort in that. What in this world can stop God? Nothing. What can overcome God? Nothing. That's where he gets excited. God is the shepherd, the beautiful shepherd, the protector. And here's the other thing. God is also, the last point here, is that God is also the director. Right? He's leading the sheep. He's telling them where they need to go, giving them the direction they need to be. He leads them with his rod and his staff for direction and for correction. He guides them. Because some sheep need to wander off a little bit and they need to be poked a little bit, right? Sometimes I'm that sheep. I wander a little bit and I need that poking from God. You ever feel that? God corrects you, brings you back, and directs you on where you need to go. He wants to take you to places that are good for you, to grow you, to strengthen you. He wants to take you places that keep you safe. He wants to direct you. But here's the catch to all that, is that it's for his name's sake. He does all this because his name is on the line. He is God. He can do no other. He cannot be a bad provider. There's a double negative there, sorry. He has to be a good provider because that's his nature. Or he wouldn't be God. He has to be a protector or he wouldn't be God. If he wasn't the ultimate protector, then he wouldn't be the Almighty God, right? If he didn't know everything, omnipotent, if he didn't understand, if he wasn't everywhere and know everything, he wouldn't be a good director, would he? He has these things for his name's sake, as the Bible says. It's not for us. It's because God is God. And he can do no other. This is a beautiful picture of God. It's his name is on the line for us. And that should bring us trust and comfort. This should excite us. It's for his name's sake. Not to give us butterflies, but because he can do no other. So God is the shepherd here. It's a beautiful picture of God. And we need to get a hold of that. If we want to go any further in this psalm, we need to understand who the shepherd is. How strong he is. How powerful, how loving, how kind. And if we never understand that, we'll never understand the rest. And we hear this psalm all the time at funerals, right? The funeral psalm. I think it's in the wrong place. Because we all don't get to claim the next part. Right? So you guys all are chomping the bit to get the next part because it's like the most famous of them all. But if we don't understand this first part, we don't live into this first part as God is our shepherd, we cannot go any further in this verse. Amen. So let's move on then. I've kind of tempted. Oh, did I leave a slide out? We'll find out. Here we go. Yes, I did. I skipped ahead. I got excited. Here we go. God is my shepherd. So first, we're going to put it on there. God is not everyone's shepherd. I was kind of pointing at that. My first point. God is not everyone's shepherd. There are some people who have left the flock. Here's the thing. When we sin, when we do things that separate us from God, we leave the flock. We go out on our own. We leave the good shepherd. Right? God doesn't kick us out. We rebel against him. Romans calls us his enemies. We go against him. We are separated from him. And so those who are not following God and are not a part of his flock, he's not their shepherd. Doesn't mean he doesn't care for them. He loves them. He wants them to come back to the flock, But if they have not come, they're not his. So if they rebelled and left, they are not under his guidance anymore. The verse here talks about many are going to say, Lord, Lord, to me in the last days. And God's going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. We don't automatically come back into the fold. But my next point is this. That's not the end of the story. Because God is also the adopted shepherd. Even though that sheep has wandered away, has been separated, he said, I want to bring you back in. I want to adopt you back in. You have forsaken me. You've abandoned me. You've divorced me. But I want you back. And if we confess Christ as Lord, we make him the shepherd of our lives again, he will take us back in and make us new. Not the same old back. Bring us back in and make us something new. He will change us from the inside out. We believe in him and his power. He adopts us back in. He reconciles us and makes us new. Brings us back to the flock. It's something new. The last one is, well then how do we know if we're in the flock or out? If you follow the shepherd. See, the real sheep follow the shepherd. It's easy to pretend. In Matthew, Jesus warns about the false shepherds trying to sneak in. The false sheep, wolves in sheep clothing. They sneak in and they play the parts. They sneak in and try and look like they're part of the fold, but they are not. You see, if you're a real sheep, if God is really your shepherd, you will follow him. You will seek him. You will be known by your fruits, as the Bible says. You will be known by what comes out of you. You will be known as one of his because you're different. When we're adopted in, Christ remakes us. And so if you're a real sheep, you will be different. You will follow his teaching. Yes, you're going to mess up. Yes, you're going to make mistakes. Yes, you're going to have bad days. But God is going to grow you through that. And you're going to ask for forgiveness when you mess up. You're going to do the right things and choose the right things of God. You're not going to live a life that enjoys the things that separated you from God. You're going to forsake those things. So we'll get more into that later. I'm getting excited, get ahead of myself. But we're going to move on. This is where I was teasing to us a little bit ago, the infamous verse. What are the benefits of being a sheep then? A sheep of God. This is the next part. So, I forgot my signal there. We're going to move on. We're moving on to verse 4 here, if you follow along. And this is probably the most familiar Bible verse out there. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Whew. I get excited about that part. I don't know about y'all. That's exciting. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. All right, that's that picture. You got to picture this in your mind because, you know, in our days, we're not in the Middle East right now. And we're not walking around everywhere, riding horse everywhere. You got to picture this valley with a huge hill and this dark cavern that you're walking through, right? And the sun is behind the hills, and so there's shadows everywhere. And you don't know what is up ahead. Is it an animal that could blindside you? Is it a thief hiding, waiting? You don't know what's up around the corner. And this is the trouble of the near Middle East back in this time. There's all kinds of evil people out there. And you didn't have the police out patrolling. You're kind of on your own when you're out walking. And here we have this beautiful picture, the valley of the shadow of death, this cavern you're walking through with the shadows hiding stuff around the corner. You can't see what's around the corner, but God says, look, you don't need to fear. Oh, sorry, we're up. I got excited there. Woo! The cool part about one of the benefits of following God and being one of his sheep is that we will fear no evil. For God's rod and staff, they comfort us. When we're out there walking through that valley, right? We don't find comfort that we're invincible. All right? We don't find comfort that all is going well and the sun is shining. As God's sheep following the shepherd, we find comfort in his guidance, comfort in his direction, that what we face around that corner, he will empower us, and he'll be with us. It doesn't say that we're going to turn a corner and there's nothing there. It says we're not going to fear that evil. Maybe it's an illness hiding around that corner, waiting for you. When you come face to face with that, God says, find your comfort in me, in my ways. Maybe it's an accident. Maybe it's a loved one. That when you come around that corner, you're going to face that loved one. You're going to face that troubling situation. And God says, look, find your comfort in me. There's no reason to fear the evil out there. Comfort in me. Stop trying to find your comfort in sunny days and roses and petals and everything's feeling good, because there's going to be rough days. There's going to be rough nights. There's going to be rough years. Right? Some of those saints have been around a while. You need to say, yes, there's going to be some rough years. It's going to be hard times. But we don't find our comfort in those hard times or everything coming out okay. We find our comfort in God. His rod, his staff is what gives us that comfort. His goodness, his mercy is what gives us that ability to make it through as we go through the valley. Next point also, as we go through these things, you will have all that you need. This idea of a cup running over is not like wasteful running over. It just means it's you're satisfied. This cup is just so full, it never goes empty. You're just satisfied all the time. And here's the thing, when we hunger and thirst for God's righteousness, as Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for God's righteousness, for the righteousness. When we hunger and thirst for those things and we seek comfort in God, we are fulfilled. We are full of the living water. We have all that we need. Sometimes we watch saints, those Christians who've been around, go through difficult times. And we're like, how do they do that? How do some of these people walk through these dark places and they hold their head up high and their life's falling apart, but they're still making it? How do they do that? Because they are full of God. They're not worried about what's going to happen if they can't drive their bass boat on the weekends or they can't climb into the tree stand anymore. They're concerned about God. They're concerned about God's ways and what it means in their life. Oh, the Beast Feast speaker. I don't know how many people are here for the Beast Feast, but a guy came and spoke and he has an eye problem. I don't remember exactly, but there for a while he couldn't hunt, and he really messed him up. He just really crushed him. But eventually he found out he could hunt with a crossbow, and he's able to work through that and be able to hunt for a while. And it wasn't because God took away that. God made another way to let him enjoy that for a season. And so we need to make sure we're finding our comfort in those things of God. And when we find our comfort in the things of God, we will have all that we need. We won't care about the things of this world. They'll become just tools to us to use for God. God may give you a lot of tools to use. God may give you only a few. Your job is to use what you have to affect those around you. And here's the next thing. Beautiful picture here. Last point is that you'll have eternal rest with God. Live in my house forever. So if things do go wrong, maybe turning that corner in the cave, in the cavern, that dark shadow, is your end. Maybe God's saying it's time for you to come home. We'll have that eternal rest with God in heaven. I didn't realize this until I was reading this, and I thought about it. Wait, we read a lot in the Old Testament about, we don't hear a lot about heaven in the Old Testament. We hear a lot about going to be with the fathers. You go to the grave. And, you know, scholars debate this, but then we read this song where they say, look, there's a pointing to heaven here. You'll be in God's temple forever. You'll be with him forever. The idea of eternity. What is a few moments here on earth compared to eternity with God? A few moments of suffering, as Paul talked about, to an eternity with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. What is it? And this is a beautiful picture about following the Good Shepherd, being a part of the Good Shepherd's flock. So we're going to head towards an end here. So, here's some encouragement for the future. Are you ready? You guys ready? Or I can start over again if we need to. No, you ready? Okay, just checking. All right, here we go. First thing this. If God is your shepherd, I want to encourage you to go where he directs. Go when he directs. If he is leading you somewhere, go. Go. And then find rest in him. There's a time to go and there's a time to rest. Find your rest in him. Don't try and find your rest in Netflix shows, in drinks, and other things. Find your rest in God. Find your rest in him. And also find your comfort in him. Things in this world are going to let you down. I hate to tell you, little doggies are going to die. Little pets are going to die. Loved ones are going to pass away. And if we find our comfort in those things, we're going to be sadly disappointed. But if we find our everlasting comfort in God and in him, we'll never be left wanting. We'll mourn for those we lose here on earth, but we'll glorify God in the process. So that's some encouragement for those who God is their shepherd. Next point is this, for those who are wandering from the Good Shepherd. Maybe you were following God for a while, and life has kind of pulled you away. You've gotten busy. You've kind of wandered off. The cool thing is, once God adopts you as a sheep, it's permanent. Paul tells us there's nothing, life nor death, principalities, nothing can separate us from the love of God. So if you really became a sheep of God and you've wandered, he's saying, come back. So here's my encouragement for you. First thing is stop. Stop wandering. If you know you've separated yourself from God, you know you've let life get in the way, first thing you do is stop. Stop walking, stop running, just stop. Just stop. Next thing is drop. Some of you guys know where I'm going with this. Drop the things that are keeping you from God, right? If there's these things that are separating you from God, you're wandering. Maybe you've gotten into something that's not good, some sin, some lifestyle. Maybe it's some drugs or something like that that's pulling you away. Just drop it. It's going to be hard. It's going to be rough, but let it go. Because you can't bring it back to the flock. Let go. Stop. Drop the things. They're separating you. And finally, roll. Roll back into the fold. Come back in. If you've been wandering, God wants you back. And yes, it's going to be awkward going back to that Sunday school class that you've missed for a year. Going back to that friends that you used to do Bible studies with. Coming back, it's going to be weird, but come back. Just come back. Let the church surround you and pour into you. Let those saints pray over you and help you, encourage you, and be a part of that. Come back to the flock. And join back in all those benefits God has for you. He wants to be with you. Because when you're on your own, you're going to face some tough times. Things are going to happen. And last, as we wrap it up here, is this: if God is not your shepherd, then maybe He's calling you today. If you haven't made God your shepherd, if you haven't turned your life over to Him, just coming to church is not going to make it automatically happen. Just giving to the offering is not going to automatically make it happen. You may be a poser, pretending, hiding in the flock. A goat mixed in with a sheep. And you're like, I don't fit in here. God wants to change that. He wants to adopt you and bring you in. First thing you do is you need to confess Christ is Lord. Surrender your life to Him. Surrender it all to Him. Make Him the shepherd of your life. Say, I give it over to You. I give You direction and control. I give it all. Then believe in the power of God. Believe in what He can do in and through you. Believe that He is the good shepherd, the ultimate provider, the ultimate protector, the ultimate director. Believe in that. And then abandon those things that have separated you from God. Run away from them. Flee. And run to the Savior. And He'll adopt you. He'll bring you in. He'll start making you different. The Bible says you'll be reborn like a little infant spiritually. And you grow spiritually. As you dig into the Word of God and as the saints of God pour into you, you grow and mature. And God will change you.
If you'd like to find out more information or keep up to date on what's happening at Memorial Baptist Church, you can go to www.mbcnewhaven.com. You can follow our bulletin, stay up to date on sermons. You can also find us on Facebook or on our ChurchLink app. All the information is on our website. Please swing on by, check it out. And thank you for joining us.